Beauty photography succeeds in bringing together chaos and geometry, the world as it appears and the image that is carefully framed. And how does this combined effect of surprise and control, ingenuity and rationality, contribute to the impression that most of us share when we look at his pictures? The experience of inhabiting place, of being there. I think that a good place to start to answer these questions is a short essay written by Thierry on Walker Evans. Let me just write the date, and I know that Jacques and I are going to try to read. Let me just write the date here that Thierry's writings are full of references to Evans. The only photographer he singles out as the author I love and feel closest to. L'autore che amo e che più di ogni altro sento vicino. Despite these passionate words of love, Thierry is very lucid and rational, explaining why Evans' photography means so much to him. This is not because of this photographer's vernacular, possibly surreal and minimalist touch. Rather, he recognizes the rigor, silence, and simplicity of this photographer's eye. The way he frames the view through a classical and rigorous frontal perspective, letting light falling homogeneously into space and thus conveying the impression of a scene appearing naturally in front of the lens. And I'm hoping this can illustrate what I just said. Leggiamo in italiano. Nessuna violenza, nessuno shock visivo o emozionale, nessuna addolcinatura, e qui bisogna sottolinearlo 10 volte perché il discorso della tenerezza è estremamente complesso. Nessuna addolcinatura. Quello di Evans è uno stato di tenerezza nei confronti del mondo, una sensazione di unità e sintonia. Ogni parte del paesaggio, dai tetti delle case alle segne sui muri, sembra attendere che si posi lo sguardo amorevole di Evans per essere riconosciuta. Tutto all'interno delle sue fotografie sembra, sottolinea, naturale. Nessuno shock, nessuna addolcinatura. Ogni parte del paesaggio sembra attendere lo sguardo per essere riconosciuta e questo discorso del naturale. La sua è una visione che applica il criterio unificante di una misura, la ricerca costante di un equilibrio, una visione che comprende e contemporaneamente esclude le altre, perché trova all'interno delle coordinate e alla fissità dello spazio della camera oscura la misura dell'equilibrio per la rappresentazione dell'esterno. La sua opera è tra le poche del Novecento che lascia agli spazi, agli oggetti, ai paesaggi il compito di rivelarsi al nostro sguardo con una riservatezza, una dignità prima sconosciute. E questa continua riflessione sulle cose, sugli oggetti che si rivelano quasi naturalmente al nostro sguardo. Hence it is Evans, ossia Mook, that paradoxically shapes the world we feel empathetic towards. Giving reflections on how this photography communicates feelings of affection, tenerezza, as he says, takes into consideration an important page written by Alan Barthes in Camera Lucida, that is Barthes' description of the emotional impact provoked on him by a 19th century architectural view, Charles Clifford Alhambra. And Barthes says, an old house, a shadowy porch, a man sitting against the wall, a deserted street, a Mediterranean tree. This old photograph touches me. It is quite simply there that I should like to live. For me, photographs of landscape must be habitable, not visitable. Looking at these landscapes of predilection, it is as if I was certain of having been there or of going there. Throughout his creative life, Guiri sought out these kinds of images, what Barthes defined as landscapes of predilection. These were images that unveiled a country where not quite seen, something that was very programmatically in Viaggio in Italia, and in all numerous series that preceded this project, Colazione su a way that makes us aware of looking, helping us to reflect on those mechanisms of vision, that contributed to layers of memory. That is for Cowley, as well as this view of attitude that fits to the family snapshot that most of us can find in the albums, and I can't help seeing always my uncle in this picture every time I look at it. Layers of vision that exist in the particular Italian memory of place. But my focus today is not on this aspect of the work. I want to think about giving beyond the boundaries of Italian landscape and explore how his strategy of framing the world contributed to transform the ordinary to the extraordinary, and how his conscious operation of inclusion and exclusion of the world enhanced the impression of belonging to place. As you all ricordano, no? La cancellazione dello spazio che circonda la parte inquadrata è per me importante quanto il rappresentato, ed è grazie a questa cancellazione che l'immagine assume senso diventando misurabile. Cosa promise l'embodiment of Iris research into the bizarre, this progressive unraveling of a gigantic riddle that is made of what I call the hieroglyphs that permeate everyday life? Most photographs in the book reflect this photographer's playful framing, whereas it is a painted horse behind the bark of a shovel, a beach divided up into two parts by dark wooden posts, the edges of a local basketball field or the frame of a goalpost. I'm persuading you, Harry. The photographer's self-portrait reflected in a store window with an open mirror that frames the section of the street where he's standing with his camera. Or a spectacular sequence of 8 pictures with reflecting mirrors, especially those of a campground in Il Bus in Corsica, where these surfaces reflect the surrounding landscape, the bathers washing and passing by, the ordinary surfaces of lavatories, and one of the 8 images. In which I also thought this was a collage. I was lucky to be able to see things in New York. And in fact, as I'm sure you have marked with me, these are two mirrors that reflect the two walls that are in front of each mirror in the laboratory where you can wash your face in the campground in your house. I can't help but think of Robert Mason's photo mirror series, where the artist plays, or better, displays, a group of 12-inch square mirrors in various configurations at 9 locations of the Yucatan Peninsula and photographs these arrangements. In his ephemeral installation, Smithson investigated whether photography could be a mediated or an unmediated record of the world. As Craig Owens commented on this piece, the photograph represented the desire to fix the transitory, the ephemeral, in a stable and stabilizing image. And what was the presence of the mirrors undermined the idea that photography could be unmediated. In relationship to these matters, Giri's book project, Colorform, embraces the fragmentary nature of the photograph as a possible way to express the phenomenological experience in place and time. He embraces the fragmentary nature of the photograph. It tells us that it is precisely the act of frame that elicits this meaning and the experience of the photographic world. As Giri writes in the introduction, of course, la possibilità di analisi nel tempo e nello spazio, dei segni che formano la realtà, consente alla fotografia, grazie alla frammentarietà, di essere più vicina al non delimitabile, e cioè all'esistenza fisica. The research on the phenomenology of photography, of the nature of its mediation of time and space, harkens back, as we've already discussed, in Giri's work to the late 60s, when he began collaborating with a group of conceptual artists in Modena. And you know a lot already, of course, with Tony on the left, Morgan Tony on the right, Parmigiani, what we haven't quite discussed yet, thank God, with only one where it has been shown is De La Casa, and I'll get to that in a minute. Significant, there has been a lot of really interesting discussion on this changed, but several artists of this time, into the notion of photography as fiction and imperfect rendering, nothing documentary about it. We can see it once again on Boris Nitzan and his Monument of Passy, an unusual photographic essay published on a forum where the artist described a hypothetical bus trip from New York to Passy to New Jersey, using the snapshot as visual accompaniment to his anthropological exploration of pseudo-monuments, sandbox, and silver icon, wooden bridges, silver left, oil pipes, etc. Similarly, Nitzan's hilarious slight injection of a decayed hotel in Mexico, Hotel Palenque, where the format of the slight projection sustained a nonsensical presentation of the site in ruins, with no structure per se, nor a center. A lecture, and here summary of many of these slides, a lecture that was a flip side of an academic slide lecture in a course of modern history of architecture. In both cases, Monuments of Passy and Hotel Palenque, in both cases, photography served to Smithson as a description of a story that no longer makes sense. As he said, photographs possess the power to invent many worlds. The act of frame was key to all this project, where photography was pursued as raw technical data and impersonal record to illustrate the form of anti-reportage or a parody of photojournalism. When we think of frame, let's also think of another artist whose work appealed a great deal to theory, Ed Lucia, and his carefully constructed grid with typologies of parking lots, skate gas stations, swimming pools, and Los Angeles apartments. Think of this framing process in many of these artists. Looking closer to home, I want to bring up yet another case when the act of framing became part of the world. Campo Urbano, a one-day performance occurred on September 21st, 1969 in the historic square of Como, involving 10 conceptual artists, with Ugo Mula, co-organizer of the event, as you can see together with Calamet and Munari, with Ugo Mula, co-organizer, documenting these performances and bringing them into a book form, a book that is written on the back of Munari. This is the photograph of Mula. In this particular case, we see how Mula's camera became part of the intervention of Mario Risaldo and Carlo Ferrario, when mirrors were placed onto the ground of Piazza del Duomo, altering the landscape of the Cathedral's Doric facade, which was strangely turned on its head. The audience, together with the photographer behind the camera, was called upon as participants of the event, reflecting themselves in the mirrors and becoming agents of the artist's work. The act of framing of this project, anticipated, Ugo Mula's last body work, Verification, where he interrogated the language of photography through 14 pairs of images and text. In both works, the artist defined the notion of the camera as an objective instrument of authority, breaking down perspective, interrogating time as an abstract dimension, as we see in Thomas Jolivet's Cunelis, and presenting his records as a repetition of diverse fragments. As Mula wrote in Self-Portrait and Homage to Friedland as a Portrait for Friedland, you know, the camera is the medium which leaves me out just when I'm most present. These works, like those examined by Smithson, interrogated the possibility of recording reality through the camera, defined the notion that photography could be testimony of what actually happened. And this was certainly the line of chief one to Louis Loeb and the key text for many of his artists. At the end of the 60s, Vivi was immersed in this conceptual debate about vision and documentation, as well as in the notion of anti-reportage. In 1969, he worked with Bertoni and then with Ramaz, Claudio Tomassi, Claudio Parmigiani, Liam della Casa, he began documenting the Anima performances, and we heard already about this, in studio and in the landscape. As you know, the main lesson gained from this collaboration was that consisting in the possibility of working with the obvious and looking at it under a whole new light. The
design and the actual material construction of the photographic sequence.
also know that giving was an object for the book of that sort. So this will see it again as one of the knockout books made above, which interests me a lot, seeing how good the pictures got together on the page. And that the book was an important vehicle to draw an understanding of American photography. We had this book, I don't know anybody, but certainly about Clarence, with books, many of them were in his library, but also very important of Adrusha, for whom the books were the vehicle of photography in sequence in the 60s. And this also is the other refugee. And look at the white space around the picture of these surreal shapes of cactuses and plants floating in the white space. It is obvious when we look at Giri's Man Above that the book was an important aspect of the work. And I want to emphasize that this can help us understand the notion of frame, how Giri was able to extract and inscribe little vignettes from the totality of what he saw. Giri talked about this in his lectures, and I quote, "Credo che la fotografia consiste essenzialmente in un'opera di cancellazione del mondo esterno. Anche per questo preferisco il bordo bianco a quello nero. L'inquadratura è una cancellazione della realtà che vedo come ritorno al bianco, non al nero, e l'immagine tende a dilatarsi. E poi, secondo me, la fotografia è sostanzialmente una narrazione in sequenza, mentale. Io penso sempre a una specie di narrazione che continua oltre l'immagine singola." These words apply well to the design of two early books, titled Weekend, and later become Atlante, as you gather, but the Weekend has a lot of more, say, natural pictures of people on the beach, so on. This other one is back to the subject that we see there in Atlas, and as I said, I also want to show here, Giri configured graphically also this form of this interesting wooden box, with the plate inside and also the educational form together with the screen, you know, with the treasure box, and also the presentation for Atlante. The small column photograph is centered within a perfectly square white page, and the sequence of these little pictures highlights the selection of the scene from the totality of the spectrum, the moment in time and space when things are recognized by the camera. The way Giri conceives these books is equivalent to the way he sees the world. His page layout is yet another way of taking the picture. I'm extremely fascinated with all this, and very important aspect of his work, required to know of going back to the work. And so that's why I'm talking about the reframing. And how to be doing that graphically also. If this operation is a specialty in those series by Giri that are structured on the principle of repetition, the systematic classification of objects in identity, objects of affection that define its own identity, or the cosmic configuration of infinito, a series of 365 photographs of the sky, taking over a year and combining the colorful puzzle, or a mosaic of scattering. The act of framing as cancellation is evident in all his work. Allow me to add something else, more at the level of speculation. The speculation, though, that is supported by visual evidence, I think. I would like to think that among the wide range of gear, among the wide, huge range of influences on Giri, in his incredible mind, and vision, we can bring in also the work of Munari, his own artist books, as well as his graphic work in light sensitive material. Could Giri have seen Munari's Photochromache, a little book published by Domus in 1944, where this artist subverted the photographic essay and said quite bluntly that photographs could generate any kind of story? I'm working on this book right now, and so apologies if you don't think it makes sense. But I see a connection in the way Munari created a bit of last page of his little book. Is that here? This image put there and then other of his images. At the end of this photo essay that he creates, he tells us that nothing is true, it was just a picture that he can't exist on this figure. The way Munari created his book, letting photographs float on a white page and showing the nonsensical and playful nature of his fragment as an elegance and a substance that would have only pleased Luigi Ghirri. For sure, Munari was an influence for Mario Cresci, a contemporary of Ghirri. He was photographic practice, departed from graphic design, questioning photography and perception, and finding ways to measure the world with the camera. Cresci also explored the notion of the frame when he rotated the camera and showed three possible perspectives of the same view, also to the Malevich kind of way, of Maghera from the window. Or when Cresci scrutinized the white surfaces of Martina Frank and Puglia, searching for marks that could bring regularity to the irregularity of the architecture. And also, when Cresci reframed the family portrait in space and time, the retracting into reality, presenting a vertical sequence with an establishing shot, a group portrait, and a normal family photograph, an object of affection identifying the group. Mario and Luigi Ghirri were very good friends, and no question they look at each other's work. And Van Ben is also having a good time in the year. These operations were turned to other conceptual investigations about the camera optics. One thinks again of Hugo Mulak exploring the view from his own window and presenting three very different pictures that proved that photography was nothing other than a transformation, enlargement or reduction of the outside world. Right? You understand? Obviously, Mura on the left, to the one with Cresci, windows, and how he directly quotes from his window diagram. And one was thinking of Franco Vaccari. We have seen this image, but we've heard his name already. Franco Vaccari exploring the technological unconscious of the camera in its automatic rendering of people's faces to a photomask installed at the very same time in 1972. Significantly, the question of automatism was also on Munari's mind since 1963, when he started to generate light-sensitive patterns by feeding a rank Xerox machine with a range of surfaces and lines layered on the scanning bed. Munari's original Xerox, as we call Xerografia originally, and Vaccari's photomap installation were two extreme gestures that pursued an unmediated relationship between the recording machine and the world, some kind of world. As Munari wrote in 72, when the book came out, the technological possibilities of our time permit everyone some sort of activity and enable everyone to produce objects of aesthetic value. One of the duties of the visual operator would be to experiment, to seek out instruments suitable for general use and to pass them on with all the secrets of the trade that facilitate their operation. The artist as visual operator, who has the task, the duty of finding the instrument suitable and pass them on with all the secrets of the trade that facilitate their operation, using a mechanism that automatism as we know regarding the Xerox machine. Unlike Vaccari and Munari's technological unconscious, let's say, Ghirri sought a secret of the trade that depended on the camera vision, and I love to think of him teaching students. A vision that, as I reiterated, was based on letting the world appear spontaneously through the rigor of the optics he had chosen. His awareness of the frame built on conceptual premises and developed into a special kind of intuitive perception, generated that affection that he loved in the Ferrero's picture, and that more broadly he considered necessary for the planet. As he wrote, io credo che dietro a didattico ambiente vi sia una disaffezione che l'uomo ha sviluppato nei confronti del suo ambiente. Il recupero della rappresentazione può avere un grande peso culturale e una grande efficacia. And we do without that. How this was instrument was how he saw himself as that visual operator was using, was applying his vision to, and it was seeking that affection. There was nothing sentimental in this quest, nor was his vision confined to an Italian sensibility. His research went across media and countries in order to teach us something about camera perception, how to frame what cannot be framed. And I'm concluding here, and perhaps I should say this is why I thought of this title, Show and Tell. I'm obviously thinking of what kids do in class. They show an object and they tell a story. Well, that Show and Tell game, forgive me, left many things unsaid. Not everything was told to let us unravel and inhabit these pictures. And why not finish with his words once again, feeling them that you can read, and I can read again, because I think they are important. La fotografia è il desiderio di ridare vita mediante la luce al mondo di fuori, il sogno di dare al nostro sguardo sul mondo un altro sguardo successivo, per non dimenticarlo, per capirlo, o forse solo per la gioia